keep your eyes on me. Keep your eyes on me.
Dodd-Sterling United Methodist Church, located in Atlanta, Georgia, 3272 Browns Mill Road, Atlanta, Georgia, 30354. Our mailing address is P.O. Box 82838, Atlanta, Georgia, 30354. We want to thank you for tuning in to our weekly Sunday broadcast, where we are diligently obeying divine direction and striving to elevate redeemed living in nurturing grace. Our mission here at Dodd-Sterling United Methodist Church is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. We do this first by doing no harm, by avoiding evil of every kind, especially that which is generally practiced. Secondly, we do good by being in every kind merciful after their power, as we have the opportunity. In addition, we attend upon the ordinances of God. Amen. Amen. If you have any Bibles, like to read along with me, please turn to Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. I want to thank Reverend Williams for reading that for us and welcome him back. Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. I want to welcome everyone back who was out on vacation for the month of July. Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. I'll be reading from the King James Version of the Bible. My words may be a little different than the words in your Bible, but the Spirit of God is still the same. And it says, and let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Let me read that again. And let us not be weary in well-doing. Yes. For in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Amen. Don't grow weary. The harvest is coming. Amen. You may be seated. Don't grow weary. The harvest is coming. Let us pray. Speak, Lord, for your servants hear it. Manna from heaven, feed us till we want no more. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Don't grow weary. The harvest is coming. The Living Bible puts it this way, and do not grow tired of doing what is right, for after a while we shall reap a harvest of blessings if we don't get discouraged and give up. Have you ever felt like giving up? Have you ever felt like throwing in the towel? Have you ever poured your heart into something only to see little or no results? Have you ever woke up one morning with a sense of purpose, energetic, only to come to the end of the day feeling like your efforts have been in vain? Do you feel the sting of weariness right now when your good deeds seem to bear minimal fruit?
Come on.
I want you to know you are not alone. This is a common human experience where we feel weary and disheartened. Most of us have been there, from the pulpit to the pew. Whether it's in our jobs, in our homes, in our relationships with our children, with our spouses, with our mothers, with our fathers, in our ministries or our organizations, there comes a time when we wonder, is my hard work in vain? Well, today we're going to delve into Galatians chapter 6, verse 9, to speak to these feelings of weariness and encourage each and every person, from the pew pulpit to the pew,
yes, that
you got to persevere.
Amen.
Don't grow weary.
Yes.
The harvest is coming. Our goal today is to uncover the reasons why we should not grow weary in doing good. This will be supported by scripture, biblical examples, and real life illustrations so that you might find renewed hope and strength. But first, we want to understand, what is weariness? What is weariness, and how do we find ourselves weary? Well, weariness goes beyond physical tiredness. It encompasses emotional and spiritual fatigue.
Wow.
It's the difference between being tired from working out and being weary.
Yes. Wow.
Weary encompasses your whole being. Weariness is when you don't feel like getting up in the morning. Weariness is when you feel like calling that divorce attorney and saying, I've had enough. Weariness is when you feel like calling that bankruptcy attorney and saying, I just can't do it no more.
Come on.
Weariness is when you look at that gun on the nightstand and wonder, is it worth living for? Looking at that butcher knife or that tie in the closet saying, should I go in one more day?
Yeah.
Will it really make a difference?
Yeah, mercy.
Weariness is soul fatigue.
Yes.
Elijah felt overwhelmed and weary and ready to give up when Jezebel threatened his life. Job was weary and felt like dying when he lost everything. But my Bible tells me in Psalm 27 and 14, wait for the Lord.
Yes.
Be strong and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord.
Amen.
My Bible tells me we have need of endurance so that when we have done the will of God, we will receive the promise. My Bible tells me that we ought to rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope.
Amen.
My brothers and my sisters, I have recently started back working out, and I've started back doing push-ups and lifting a few weights and walking the treadmill and walking back around the school building, and I've gotten tired, but I understand that if I don't give up, I have some nice looking legs. If I don't give up, I won't get the dad pouch. If I don't give up, I develop muscles instead of excuses. If I don't give up. So now that we understand what weariness is, it is a fatigue in the spirit. It's emotional fatigue. We need to look at, why do some of us get weary? I'm glad you asked.
some of us get weary because we bear burdens. We bear one another's burdens so that we can fulfill the law of Christ. We carry other people's emotional and physical burdens, and this can be exhausting. We also get weary because we have to examine ourselves because of personal responsibility, personal accountability. We've done things we should not have done and gone places we should not have gone, and we feel like we ought to just throw in the towel because we think that somebody's going to show up and let people know that the gig is up. And we grow weary. Some of us grow weary because of deception. We've been deceived, and then we deceive ourselves.
Yes.
We think we are better than what we really are, and we deceive ourselves. We think we finer than what we really are, and we deceive ourselves. We think we are healthier than what we really are, and we deceive ourselves, and so we get weary.
Yes.
Some of us are just reaping what we sow. We went out to the club and spent all our money. We're reaping what we sowed. We didn't come home last night. We're reaping what we sowed. We didn't go to school like we should have. We skipped. We spent more time in the bathroom than we did in the books. And we're just reaping what we sowed. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. Whatever a person sows, that shall we also reap.
Amen.
The person that sows to the flesh will reap corruption, but the one who sows to the Spirit will reap everlasting life. So some of us have just reaped what we sowed. And that's why we're weary. Some of us need to understand that there is no immediate reward when you do good. So some of us have done good and we expect an immediate reward, and that has not happened. And we're wondering, when will it happen? So we're weary. We're tired. We're tired of doing good. We're tired of standing outside giving out boxes only to have folks never come into the church on Sunday morning. Never to give back to the church, to give so much to them. We're tired. We're tired of building houses only to have none of the folks whose houses we built come by the church. We're looking for immediate reward.
Yes.
But once again, let us not grow weary in well doing. For in due season we shall reap if we faint not, because this is a marathon and not a sprint.
Amen.
The Bible tells us as we have the opportunity, we ought to do good to all, especially to those who are of the household of faith. Amen. So now we understand weariness. We understand why we end up being weary. Now we need to understand God's promise. God's promise is that we shall receive a reward in due season.
Yeah.
In due season means that God's timing is not your timing.
Amen.
God's timing is not my timing. We shall receive a reward in due season. You know, the average person takes 4 years to get a bachelor's degree. The average person takes 1 year or 2 years to get a master's degree. The average person takes 7 to 10 years to get a PhD. But it ain't always on their timing, but it's on God's timing. In order to get the blessing that God promised us, we got to wait and work while we are waiting.
Yeah.
Joseph, after years of suffering and waiting, received the promise of the Lord. For we have need of endurance, so that after we have done the will of God, we may receive the promise. That's Hebrews 10 and 36. James 1 and 12 says, blessed is the man who endures temptation, for when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. No, this man might not be the right man right now, but the next one might. This woman might not be the right woman, but the next one might. This job may not be your retirement job, but the next one might. But you won't know if you don't keep going. We must not grow weary in well doing, for we shall reap if we faint not. There is a promise of a reward. You know, Noah spent years building the ark and facing ridicule. But Noah's faith and perseverance were rewarded when the rain came. You never know, you're building an ark to save someone. But you got to endure. I got to endure. We got to endure.
Yeah.
Thomas Edison failed thousands of times, but he did not give up until he invented the light bulb. And now look at this. We got lights all over the place. We must understand the principle of sowing and reaping. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 9 and 6, but this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Do not grow weary in well-doing. You shall reap if you faint not. If you understand sowing and reaping, Proverbs 11 and 18 says, the wicked man does deceptive work, but he who sows righteousness will have a sure reward. No, you have not gotten that house yet. But notice the key word is yet. It's coming. The new house is coming. But you got to put that deposit up. You got to have that earnest money. You got to clean up that credit.
Yeah.
Got to make a sacrifice. Stop eating out all the time. Every day and twice on weekends. Can't hang out with the boys and the girls all the time. Tell them I'm buying me a house. I'm trying to be a curse breaker and a wealth builder. Because the Bible says a righteous person leaves an inheritance to their children's children.
Yes.
So you're not doing this for just yourself. You're doing this for your grandkids. And you're going to have a will, and you're going to have a trust, so that they can't be fighting about it when you pass away. Because that's what we do as we are not growing weary, but understanding the harvest is coming. So we understand, those who sow in tears shall reap in joy. The person who continually goes forth weeping, bearing seed for sowing, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing their sheaves with them. Psalms 126, 5 and 6. Do y'all remember Ruth? Ruth lost her husband, lost her livelihood. But her dedication to Naomi and her hard work in Boaz's fields led to her becoming an ancestor. ancestor of King David and Jesus Christ. Because she didn't give up. Maybe y'all don't like Ruth. Maybe y'all like Sha'Carri Richardson. Y'all remember Sha'Carri Richardson, right? She lost her mother, tested positive for drugs, and now just won a silver medal in the Olympics because she didn't quit. Don't grow weary in well-doing, for you shall reap if you faint not. We draw our strength from the Lord. That's my final point. We draw our strength from the Lord. The Bible tells us in Isaiah 40 and 31 that those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Philippians 4 and 13 says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. So we need to understand weariness. We need to understand where weariness comes from. We need to understand that God promises us a reward. We need to understand that we got to endure. We need to understand the principles of sowing and reaping. And we need to understand that we find our strength in the Lord. Despite facing immense persecution, imprisonment, and hardship, Paul relied on God's strength to continue his missionary work and writing most of the New Testament. So as we get ready to leave this place after communion, I want you to encourage yourself. I want us to understand that weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning. Amen. Babies are not born in a minute. It takes 9 months. For all of the stuff that made us to come together. It's going to take some time for all of this to come together. It's going to take some time for you to get out of debt because you didn't get out of debt in one day, get in debt in one day. It's going to take time for you to change your life and change your situation. But when it occurs, you'll be able to rejoice knowing that you endured. To me. So don't grow weary in well-doing. Trust in God's timing and God's promise of that the harvest is coming. Let us find strength in Him and remain steadfast in our faith. Let us stand. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea bellows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control that Christ has regarded my helpless state and hath shed his own blood for my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of his glorious thought, my sin not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well It is well with my soul. And Lord, haste today when the faith shall be sight. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trumpet shall sound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well. It is well with my soul. My brothers and my sisters, I urge each and every one of us here today to commit ourselves wholeheartedly to Christ. Even when the road seems challenging. Yes, I know you ain't got the money to go to school. Our government does, though. Yes, I know that you only want to work 8 hours, but you might need to work 12 to 16 to get out of debt. Yes, I know that man and that woman don't always treat you right. But first we need to look within before we look without. Not trying to blame you, but just ask yourself, do I play a part in the situation that I found myself in? What can I do better? I can't change them, but I can change me. My good friend from Gary, Indiana, where I don't know my boy, my cousin, Michael Jackson, say, I'm starting with the man in the mirror.
Everybody, come on.
I'm asking him to change his way.
Yes, sir.
Are you struggling? Are you ready to give up? Give it to God. I heard somewhere in the Bible where it says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. The load too heavy for you, give it to God. Give it to God. Come to Christ. If you don't know him in the part of your sin. Give it to God. Just want to tell you that I love you, Lord, more than anything.
Amen.
You know, if we love God like we said we love God,
amen,
some of this stuff wouldn't even bother us.
Amen.
The money wouldn't bother you because you would know that he owned a cattle on a thousand.
He did.
The gold is his, the silver is his. And all we got to do is come up with an idea and follow that idea all the way through till you get to God. Start that business. What are you waiting for? It might be too late. Door of the church is now open. You may come. Won't you come? Won't you come? Seeing there none, you may be seated. There's always room in the kingdom.
Amen.
Christ our Lord invites to the table all who love him, all who earnestly repent of their sin, all who seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. We're on page 12. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, O God, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, O God, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this. All of you, this is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins." Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ
will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one with one another, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, our honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever and ever. Amen. The body of Christ was broken for us. Take it in. The blood of Christ that was shed for the remission of our sins. Take and drink. Amen. Let's remember our meetings that we have scheduled for today. Let's remember our men's Bible study again and again tomorrow, 7 o'clock. 6 o'clock, 6 o'clock. Men's Bible study tomorrow at 6 o'clock. Monday, prayer call, choir rehearsal, 7 o'clock Tuesday. Wednesday Bible study is on Zoom, 7 o'clock. Thursday, United Women in Faith. 6 o'clock. Okay, so y'all, 6 to 8, amen. Okay, 6 o'clock. Choir rehearsal, 6 to 8, amen. Amen. So we busy here. Amen. And we will reap if we faint not. Amen. Amen. Let us sing. Oh, I need to have the lights taken out. All right, come on, Jay. I'm hot. Church said, amen, amen, amen.